Hello friends, welcome to Learning Space. Current Affairs S&T Health and Environment for 36th week, we have module number 1 as Tropical Cyclones. Let's quickly look into the fact of tropical cyclones all over the world. What is a tropical cyclone? It is regarded as one of the devastating effects of natural calamity that helps to lose thousands of lives. Now, these tropical cyclones are generally originating in the tropical regions with a maximum sustained wind speed of 63 kilometers per hour, and they mainly cause havoc in the coastal areas with violent winds and violent storms. So let us see the tropical cyclones names of the different regions. We have tropical cyclones in the entire world divided into mainly three names. While hurricane is usually called in the American continent, we call cyclone it in the Indian subcontinent, and the same tropical cyclone can be named as typhoon in the areas of Philippines and Japan. But remember, they are all tropical cyclones. We can see the areas of tropical cyclones around the world. While hurricanes are caused by the North Atlantic Ocean and the Northeast Pacific Ocean. Cyclones are generally caused in the Pacific, South Pacific Ocean and Indian Ocean, and typhoon is caused in the Northwest Pacific Ocean. So these are the areas of the tropical cyclones all across the world. Now if you see from the equatorial region, they are already stretched to 30 degrees of latitudes both in the north and the south. But generally, tropical cyclones are not found usually in the equatorial region of 0 to 5 degrees north and south. Why it is not found there? Because we have to come to a fact called as Coriolis effect. Okay, let us see this diagram. Now, cyclone is the area of low pressure. Okay, remember, cyclone is the area of low pressure. So, when there is an area of low pressure develops, the area has low amount of air. So, in the low pressure area, areas of high pressure air from high pressure will come and take its place. So, when this happens in the northern hemisphere, the wind deviates to their right. So, you can see the wind is trying to come to the low pressure but deviating to the right. Same thing, the wind is coming to the low pressure area and deviating to their right. So, basically the wind is deviating to their right. This effect is called Coriolis effect. Coriolis effect. And for this effect, generally we see the movement of the air, the deflection of the air to the right in the northern hemisphere, and ultimately when the air moves to the right in the northern hemisphere, it creates a counterclockwise motion, anti-clockwise motion. You can see this is a anti-clockwise motion. So, it creates anti-clockwise motion. This is very important in regards to how a cyclone develops in the northern hemisphere. Just the opposite happens in the southern hemisphere. So, we will take a look at the northern hemisphere here in this module. The cyclone develops in an anticlockwise fashion due to Coriolis effect, and the equator region from 0 to 5 degrees north and south is spared of any cyclones usually because of the Coriolis force. The Coriolis force is so weak there that the winds are drifted and no rotation occurs of the wind. The cyclone can't form there. Remember, that is why 5 degrees to 30 degrees north and 5 degrees to 30 degrees south, we will see cyclones called as tropical cyclones around the world. Okay, let us come to the basic thing, that how does a tropical cyclone develops. Now, remember that tropical cyclone develops over ocean. It is a low pressure system. Let us understand clearly. What happens is the ocean should be warm, okay? Ocean should have temperature more than 26.5 degree Celsius. That means the ocean temperature should be warm. Now, as warm air rises up, it forms cloud. We know that the clouds, when it goes above, it cools there and it releases heat. So when it cools, when it condenses, it releases heat. Now this heat warms up the surrounding air, and ultimately what happens, the pressure decreases in that area, means air is moving up because the heat released, it is warming up the air, the pressure is decreasing, and more air of the surrounding place is trying to take its position. So the moisture from the sea, it is fueling the continuous generation of these winds. How? The winds are going up, laden with moisture. This moisture is now releasing heat because they are condensing and they are taking in surrounding air. So what is happening? More and more air is going into the entire unit. It is forming kind of an engine with a rapidly increasing number of winds, because the air which it is taking, it starts to rotate. Just now we heard about the Coriolis effect. The wind starts to rotate and it forms a depression. Okay, this is a term called as tropical depression. It is arising over a tropical surface, tropical sea surface, where the air is getting heated, going above, forming clouds, releasing heat and warming up the surrounding air. So low pressure is developing, more air is coming to it, and it is continuously cycling, it is continuously happening in loop. So this is the major cause of developing a tropical depression. Now at this point it will be called tropical depression. After this, if it is continuing to develop, it will give rise to tropical storm. And further developments, because it is growing on the ocean, it will continuously get moisture, it can continuously develop, so it can cause to a very heavy formation which we call as a cyclone or sometimes a super cyclone. Okay, so let us start with the structure of a tropical cyclone. You can see in a tropical cyclone there are three main parts. One is eye, okay, then second one is eye wall, and the third one is rain band. So what is eye? Eye is the centermost part of a mature tropical cyclone. We can see the eye from the satellite pictures. We can see the centermost part of the tropical cyclone. When it is becoming mature, when it is becoming very heavy as a cyclone, then it can have a eye formation. Okay, here unlikely the winds are very light, and it is a very calm area of the entire cyclone. Okay, but after eye comes the most dangerous part, that is the eye wall. Okay, that is the ring of thunderstorms which is circling the eye, and there is having maximum amount of rain. Okay, it is carrying the maximum amount of clouds, and it is having the strongest winds in that area. So maximum rain and strongest winds in that area of the eye wall. And thirdly, we have rain bands. Rain bands are a kind of alternative bands in that entire cyclone area. We can see rain bands here from a satellite picture, and here you can see rain bands from a close-up picture of a general tropical cyclone. What you can see is after the eye wall, there is a 100-mile stretch of these bands which contains cumulus and cumulonimbus clouds. They are rain laden clouds, moisture laden clouds, and they result in thunderstorms and tornadoes and huge amount of rainfall wherever they strike the land. So let us see, after the structure of a tropical cyclone, what are the effects of a tropical cyclone cause on the land? We have two dangerous effects of tropical cyclone, mainly landfall and storm surge. What is landfall? Landfall, as the name says, that it, the storm, the cyclone is coming and hitting the land. Okay, so a tropical cyclone makes landfall when the center of the storm, that is the eye, moves towards the land and ultimately hits the land. So obviously we can see that the damage that it occurs is mainly through the eye wall. Okay, so the eye wall, which is the second part after the eye, damages the area with core of heavy strong winds, okay, and heavy rainfall. So that is the landfall effect of tropical cyclone. Another effect is there which the geographists or climatology find very important, because they are one more devastating part of cyclones or hurricanes, is storm surge. Okay. Now, what is storm surge? Storm surge is an abnormal rise of water over the normal tide. Means when the cyclone is pushing towards the land, it pushes the water towards the land and it causes a surge. So, the surge is produced by water that is pushed towards the shore by a force of winds that is moving cyclonically around the storm, and it poses great damage. So, remember, there are two effects. One is landfall, the second one is storm surge. These are the effects of tropical cyclones. We will again see the areas of tropical cyclones around the world. We see hurricanes, we see cyclones, we see typhoons as the major tropical cyclones. Now, we will come to the hurricanes. What are hurricanes? Okay. Hurricanes are actually nothing but tropical cyclones. So, their formation will be just the same as tropical cyclones. Okay. So, first they start as tropical disturbances, where from the warm oceans. Remember, only warm oceans can cause tropical cyclones. Their temperature, again I am telling, should be 26.5 degrees Celsius or more. Okay. Tropical disturbances then become tropical depressions. So, tropical disturbances again over the warm ocean can reach high wind speed of 62 kilometers per hour and become tropical depression. Then this depression can reach 63 kilometers per hour speed and it can become tropical storm. And if they are sustaining itself and gaining more energy, then we call it a hurricane. And the wind speed in a hurricane can reach up to 119 kilometer per hour. So, it is a kind of a speed of a fast moving ball. So, that is the dangerous speed of a hurricane. And that is how hurricanes are formed around the American continent. Let us see how Sahara Desert or the east part of America contribute to the hurricane. Sahara Desert is generally hot and dry. How it can cause hurricane to the American continent? Here the wind that is called as easterly winds comes into play. What happens is, the easterly winds are generated by the hot Sahara Desert and the wet areas of Gulf of Guinea. So, here from the wet winds and the dry winds are colliding, and they are resulting in the strong altitude winds called as African easterly jet. They are strong winds that are blowing towards west, towards the west, and they are causing westward disturbances. So, here you can see they are moving towards west and they are causing westwards disturbances. And when these disturbances are moving towards Atlantic, ultimately what is happening? They are gathering more moisture here. So, this area is warm. Okay, you can see this region where the easterly winds are moving towards the west part. Okay, they are gathering more moisture, preferably in the September time when the sea are relatively warmer. Okay, they are gathering the moisture from the warm waters in the Gulf of Mexico part, in the Caribbean Sea part, and ultimately it is developing into a hurricane. Okay. Now, one more thing that comes into our mind, that there is another term called as tornado. Is there any difference? Yeah, obviously is. Hurricane and tornadoes, remember, are slightly different terms. Let us understand the basic differences between the two. Hurricanes are large scale circulating wind, while tornadoes, the basic difference comes here that they are small scale circulating wind. And remember, hurricanes travel very large distances, okay, they travel large distances, while tornadoes can have a short distance travel. They have a short lifespan and short distances, okay. And remember, hurricanes can have a week's lifetime, while tornadoes have a short lifetime. Hurricanes form over a warm sea surface, and tornado may form within the hurricanes or cyclones, or they can form just over land. They are called as dust devils, okay. So, remember, there is a difference between hurricane and tornado. And one more thing, that tornadoes are more frequent in USA and less frequent in our country, India. Okay, and the tornadoes can travel at speeds of even 300 kilometer per hour. Okay, so that is why they are sometimes called as dust devils. Let us look at the speed differences between the two. Now, hurricane speed is proposed and determined into categories by National Hurricane Center. They use a scale called as Saffir-Simpson Hurricane Wind Scale. Okay, you can see category 1 to 5 based on the wind speeds. You can see wind speeds are generally increasing as the categories are increasing. Okay, but here in case of categories of cyclone, we have difference of wind speeds. They are generally fixed by IMD, that is Indian Meteorological Department. Okay, so we have a difference in wind speeds. Remember, in hurricanes, they are very much higher wind speeds. Okay, they are categorized from category 1 to 5, and here we name them as tropical cyclone, severe cyclone, very severe, and super cyclone. So these are our categories in India, and in the American continent, they are categorized as category 1 to 5. Okay, now let's come to the naming of hurricanes. Okay, the hurricanes have a name because it is very easier for communication than the giving just a set of numbers, because it is very difficult to remember numbers. Now, you can see there is a name of a girl and a boy alternatively. Okay, this is because they are fixed by World Meteorological Organization with a list of alternate female, male and female names. Okay, and they are used on a 6-year rotation. That means, suppose I'll give you an example that Arlene, this cyclone happened around 2011. Again, the list repeated, and Arlene came around 2017 again. Okay, except there will be some major names of hurricanes removed from the list because they can be catastrophic or they have had a history of huge devastation. Okay, huge destruction. So, that is why suppose Hurricane Harvey, Hurricane Irma may not come in the next list. But anyways, this list is repeated after 6 years. Okay. So, generally we are seeing now Hurricane Harvey, Hurricane Irma, both of them has done catastrophic destruction in the east coast of American continent. And next coming is Hurricane Jose. Let us see the pathway of Hurricane Harvey in a quick look. Hurricane Harvey, you can see that this is where the Hurricane Irma has come, and this is the pathway of Hurricane Harvey. So, Harvey is a male name, Irma is a female name. So, you can understand that how alternative male and female names are used. So, this is Texas region which is devastated by Hurricane Harvey. Hurricane Irma's path rather went towards the eastern part of Gulf of Mexico, that is the Miami region, and it went up towards Georgia. And one more hurricane is coming. They are telling that it can have a devastating effect on even New York City and Washington because it is traveling towards the east coast of America. So, this is upcoming hurricane, Hurricane Jose. So, these are the hurricanes part which happens around the American coastline, okay, generally the eastern American coastline. Next come how to name a cyclone. Remember, cyclones are happening in the Indian continent, Indian subcontinent. And we have similar type of rules for naming the cyclones, but here one difference is there. The name of cyclones in the Indian seas are arranged by alphabetical order of the 8 countries, okay, 8 countries around where cyclone is generally occurring, which ultimately makes it 64 names. Okay, to understand it better, let us come to this slide. You can see there are 8 lists, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You can see 8 list. 8 countries are there. Okay, starts from Bangladesh, ends with Thailand. You can see the countries are arranged in an alphabetical order. Okay, first Bangladesh, then India, then Maldives, like that. And they have given names in particular order. Now, these names will be followed one by one. Okay, and in the bracket, you can see some years are written. They signify that is the last cyclone, okay, in that year. Okay, suppose in 2004 the cyclone O'Neill came, then came Agni. So, Agni was the last cyclone of 2004, that is why 2004 is written in the bracket. And this entire naming is been suggested by IMD. Okay, and the 8 countries have prepared a list and it is followed by IMD to give the any cyclone a name whenever it crosses a speed limit of 34 knots or 63 kilometers per hour. Okay, you can also see this cyclones, recent cyclones as Vardha, Asiri, Mora cyclone happened in 2017. So, these are the recent cyclones and this is how in Indian subcontinent we give them names. Okay, so this is the nomenclature part of cyclones as well as hurricanes are covered. Lastly, we come to this fact that why Indian east coast gets more cyclonic activity than the west coast. It is a very common observation that in our Bay of Bengal there is lot of generation of cyclonic activity. Why it is so? Because the Bay of Bengal gets the cyclonic storms, gets the winds from the southeast Bay of Bengal or the remnant of the typhoons that is generating from Japan, that is the northeast Pacific Ocean or the South China Sea. Those are coming towards Bay of Bengal. Okay, those winds are coming towards Bay of Bengal and it is causing a disturbance in the southeast region of Bay of Bengal. It is the southeast region. So, basically it is the east coast of India which faces the cyclonic activity. Okay, now this frequency of typhoons over northwest Pacific is very high. So, that is why the Bay of Bengal also get the increased share of cyclones. Okay, and remember Bay of Bengal is warmer than the Arabian Sea. That is why more cyclonic thunderstorms develop in this region. But now let us look at the entire Asian continent. In that you can see that this part is Arabian Sea. In Arabian Sea there can be less cyclonic activity with regards to the Bay of Bengal part. Why? Because in the Arabian Sea, the cyclones either originate from the southeast area or they are remnants of the Bay of Bengal which has to move from the whole landmass, which has to move towards the Arabian Sea after covering the entire South Indian Peninsula. Okay. So, this fact makes the cyclones over the Arabian Sea weak, okay, they become weak and they can't hit the western coast of India with that vigor. And remember, the Arabian Sea is relatively colder than Bay of Bengal. So, basically the Arabian Sea in the west coast doesn't form much cyclones, okay, and if it forms, then it generally goes upwards towards Karachi or it can go to the left and hit Oman. Okay, so therefore, our west coast is relatively safer in regards to cyclonic activity, which generally we see lot more in the Bay of Bengal in the east coast. This is because the typhoonic activity are fueling more cyclonic activity in the Bay of Bengal region. Let us come to the end of the module with some questions. Question number one, in the northern hemisphere, tropical cyclones in the middle latitude cyclones are similar in some context. Okay, suppose you don't know middle latitude cyclone, how can we generate the wrong sentences out of this four? Let us see that. Originate over warm ocean. Warm ocean is generally found in the tropical region, so maybe this is not the correct option. They intensify with increasing height in the ground, generally move from east to west, have winds that blow counterclockwise around their centers. Now, basically the question says that in the northern hemisphere, we know that main important thing is that the winds are blowing counterclockwise. Remember Coriolis effect, the winds are blowing counterclockwise. Okay, this is the correct option for our question number one. Okay, tropical cyclones and middle latitude cyclones are similar, that they have winds that blow in the counterclockwise directions because of Coriolis effect. Question number two, a relatively small rotating funnel that extends downward from a base of towering cloud with thunder, lightning and strong gusty winds. Obviously, it is the definition of the tornado. So, answer number B is the correct. Question number three is, the greatest damage to life and property from a hurricane is due to Okay, so you can have four options, but storm surge is definitely one of the options which actually makes a difference, because the hurricane has generally more devastating effects because of the incoming storm surge that splashes onto the entire coastline of any American state. Okay, which of the following parts of a tropical cyclone is characterized by the strongest winds, tallest clouds and heaviest rains? So out of this four, which you think it is eyewall. Okay, why eyewall is the correct answer? Because you see, it is characterized by strongest winds, it has the tallest clouds and it has the heaviest rains. The eyewall is the most dangerous part of the entire hurricane or tropical cyclone. So that B answer is the correct one. Thus we come to the end of the module. For such informative videos, stay tuned to Learning Space.